We are delighted to be a part of this, as we first were in 2001. The partnership was one of the first organizations that embraced me when I came to Boston, followed very soon thereafter by the Boston Athenaeum. We recognize Richard Wendorf, our librarian and director. And it's so important to me that Boston's most august and, in a sense, Bostonian institution should extend such a warm embrace to the partnership. The partnership was just a fledgling organization when you had your first collaboration, and it's been an annual event ever since. Tonight we have a hip-hop conversation. Do you know how hard it is to find jokes about hip-hop? Hip-hop and acupuncture, those are the two subjects. Two subjects on which there seem to be no jokes at all. In fact, I thought I was going to have to be reduced to telling light bulb jokes. And since we were in the company of singers, we could run through the vocal parts. How many basses does it take to change a light bulb? None. Basses don't change light bulbs. They're so macho they'd rather wander around in the dark and stub their toes. Or how many tenors does it take to change a light bulb? Four. One to change the bulb, and three to say that they could have done better if they'd been given the opportunity. How many altos does it take to change a light bulb? Also four. One to change the bulb, and three to say, "Isn't that a little high for you, dear?" And of course, where would we be without the sopranos? How many sopranos does it take to change a light bulb? None. The accompanist does it for her. In despair, I emailed my son Ben and said, "Ben, why are there no hip-hop jokes?" And Ben thanked you. I think you found the only SFW, that's safe for work, the only safe for work hip-hop joke in captivity, which is, how many rappers does it take to change a light bulb? Two. One to change the bulb and one to hold up his pants. At this point, it gives me great pleasure to welcome Beverly Edgehill. Dr. Beverly Edgehill, I should say. Beverly, you have such lovely petite feet that I can't say you had big shoes to fill and fill them so beautifully. But all of us who so admired your predecessor were trembling when we thought who might possibly succeed her. And you, with your background in as a vice president of Fidelity, your doctorate in education, your 30-year residence in Boston. Why, you've almost been here long enough to be classified as a Bostonian. we'd like to ask you, please, in the name of the partnership, to welcome us and say a few words.
Thank you. Isaiah, thank you for those kind words and those very funny jokes. Thank you. Good evening, everyone. It is my pleasure to bring the partnership as an organization to this very fine institution this evening to engage in a very contemporary discussion, on a topic that touches all of our lives, whether or not we know it. And I'll tell you a very short story at the risk of embarrassing my son, who's in the audience. He just rolled his eyes. But I will say that I became interested in the topic of hip-hop and the culture of hip-hop when my son turned 13. He's now 14. And I was very frustrated with the music, the commercialized presentation of hip-hop. And because I like to think of myself as a good parent, as a good American citizen, I thought rather than attempt to push it aside, let me at least venture toward embracing it by understanding it. So last summer, the partnership organization, and by the way, just a 50,000-foot definition or introduction to the partnership, we are a leadership and career mentoring organization for professionals of color here in the greater Boston community. We have a 19-year history, and we have over 1,500 alumni who have completed our leadership program. We're very proud of that. So as I was saying, last summer we hosted an event with our most senior executives on this very topic. We felt that if they were in the powerful positions they are in the city of Boston, it would be important that they understood the culture of hip-hop. And so we had tremendous success with that. And when I met with both Stephen and with Richard to talk about what might be a first venture under my tenure as leader of the organization, I said, why not bring the hip-hop conversation to the museum? And they very graciously agreed to do so. So I'm very pleased to be with you this evening. I tell you, standing here, you all are so beautiful. It's beautiful to look out among this crowd and see the wonderful, diverse faces here. And I'm very much looking forward to the great conversation we're going to have this evening. Thank you.
Stephen Nonak, you have done an amazing job in putting this together. And when we had one of our preparatory meetings, you and I had the feeling that we should just run the tape recorder. And what our colleagues were coming out with that afternoon, the wisdom, the insights, that would suffice. And from that, we generated our format for the evening. Each of our participants will say a few words, 6 to 9 minutes, on a subject of their choosing, and then they will speak among themselves. The moment we've all been waiting for. Actually, of course, the moment we're really waiting for is the moment when we get to ask questions. And that will hit about 10 minutes past 7. At 25 past 7, Monica will hit the gong, and we will thank you all very much, and adjourn for wine in the ballroom, and handouts that Stephen has so thoughtfully prepared. So if words fly by you and you think, what does that mean? Or groups, oh, I wanna know about that group, they may very well be on your handout. My favorite centenarian, Jacques Barzin, suggests that Western culture has entered its decadent phase. Not a value judgment, this, but an objective statement. While those of us who remember black and white television marvel that any behavior at all could be deemed transgressive. Everything seemingly is permitted in some quarter. Enter hip-hop, a true indigenous form. For a young woman like our guest, Renee Graham, growing up in New York in the 70s, it was just the music that you danced and roller skated to. Hip-hop before it even had a name. And what a curious form it was. Compilations and excerpts, mashups made possible by emerging technologies, an announcer or DJ with the gift of gab intoning words spoken, chanted, and some sonic objet trouvé, like phonograph needles scratching over vinyl records. Now there's an effect to make parents shudder. Accompany it with distinctive styles of dance, an outlandish uniform, an incomprehensible argot, and presto, a cultural phenomenon. In the ensuing 30 years, hip-hop's identity evolved as it spread worldwide, in Arab Paris or in Johannesburg. Hip-hop became the musical language of the young and disenfranchised. Elders castigated it, laying at its feet the ills of the age. Yet, consider, it has not gone away. What in this form allowed it to flourish, to transcend a gangster phase and to become a vibrant means of expression for everything from churches to Madison Avenue's temples of mammon? Naturally, it had going for it the prerequisite of any self-respecting youthful rebellion. It inspires parental horror. It also speaks, or maybe once spoke, with the authentic voice of America's other. Poor, black, hostile, and worst of all, threatening. Perhaps a conversation is in order. For blackness, as we know it, has a peculiarly American identity. We can understand blackness best as an evolving, idiosyncratic notion that developed within our emerging nation. Its welcoming binary included or excluded folks from the rights and privileges of life in the melting pot on the basis of a simple one-drop rule. Yet, as Ronald Redano suggests, blackness also forms the foundation of America's racial identity. The essential grounding of our continually evolving notion of what it means to be white. No black, no white. Through the centuries, we have remained fused in our complementary and mutually reinforcing identities. So make no mistake, hip-hop speaks for all America. Violent, misogynistic, homophobic, sybaritic. Pay attention, listen carefully, watch closely. Hip-hop can be all of these. So can our nation. Welcome then to our hip-hop conversation. Our participants, Professor Murray Forman, Northeastern University, author of The Hood Comes First, Race, Space, and Place in Rap and Hip-Hop, and co-editor of That's the Joint, the Hip-Hop Studies Reader. Author and commentator Renee Graham of the Boston Globe's Life in the Pop Lane column, and National Public Radio's Here and Now, heard on WBUR-FM. Educator and hip-hop artist Phil Haddix, teacher at Fletcher Maynard Academy, Cambridge, and coordinator of the Just to Start Career Connection Program at Cambridge Ringe and Latin High School. Professor Jeff Ward, College of Criminal Justice, Northeastern University, and a member of the faculty of the Institute for Race and Justice, a student and keen observer of the changing dynamics of hip-hop culture and the black community. Dr. Haddix, why don't you lead us off?
One, two, one, two. Everyone hear my voice out there? If you can hear my voice, let me hear you say yeah.
Yeah.
All right, this is an audience. We got to start it out to create the hip-hop atmosphere. So I'm going to see if you can follow me real quick as we set the tone. When I say one, two, you say three. One, two.
Three.
One, two.
Three.
When I say M, you say C. M.
C.
M. C. We're ready. We're totally ready. As the introduction went, my name is Phil Haddix, Sr., and I am coordinator of Career Connection Program in Cambridge at Ringe Latin High School. Also, at the Fletcher Maynard Middle School in Cambridge, I run a program called Broken Fingers. And the Broken Fingers is a video game literacy program. And I'll talk a little bit more about that as the discussion goes underway, because video games has almost a parallel experience to hip-hop in the sense that it's becoming mainstream now. You're seeing a lot of games, a lot of negativity, a lot of people collaborating to start clubs where you can go in during your lunch break and play at a bar and play video games at the same time. But I'll speak a little bit more about that later. What I want to do is set a context for hip-hop. And the other thing I have to do is, in this reality of hip-hop, one end, I'm named Phil Haddix. In the hip-hop world, I'm known as the invisible man, known for representing the unseen, the unheard, and the unspoken. So there will be a lot of things that you know about, hopefully some things that I've said that you haven't heard before. But we want to make sure that we collaborate so that we can have all questions asked and all questions answered before we leave. With hip-hop, one of the misconceptions that happens a lot is we have people who talk about rap music or a particular rap lyric that they heard. Someone used the B word or the H word. Someone talked about their tennis shoes, and I either like it or I don't like it. And what that is that rap music is an element of hip-hop. Rap music comes out of hip-hop. Rap by itself does not represent the totality of hip-hop. When you look at hip-hop, to really get an understanding of it, you have to take it into the larger context. And that means not only looking at the culture, but looking at black culture, looking at American culture, and to give you a better understanding why people in rap act a certain way, speak about certain things. When rap was started in the South Bronx around 72, 1974, by a man by the name of DJ Kool Herc, the big thing that was going on was a party scene. And along with Kool Herc was a gentleman by the name of African Bambaataa. And his principles for hip-hop were very simple. Peace, unity, love, and having fun. Just what we're going to be doing tonight. That is our theme. If someone in this room should jump up and throw a book at me, that's not what we were trying to do. We're here for peace, love, unity, and having fun. We might see different things happen, but that's the groundbreaking principle that it started with. With hip-hop, you express yourselves in 10 different ways. You have one, emceeing. Rapping is a part of emceeing. You can see someone on stage like Mr. Jackson just did. He's transitioning us through the event. He's telling us what we're here for and what we're going to be doing. If he rap, that will be one of his attributes, but he can speak to you and still be an MC. Another element is DJing. DJing is the foundation of it because the partying is what started the culture. Spinning records. Back in the 70s, what they were trying to do is recreate and bring back funk and soul music. This was music their parents listened to, and they wanted to incorporate that into their lifestyle. Another element is graffiti art. And as I go through these elements, you can notice graffiti art and rap are two different things. So if you say you don't like hip hop or you do like hip hop, you really have to be specific towards what aspect. Graffiti art, doing marquees, letter writing, computer lettering, bubble letters. There's also breakdancing. This is the expression that you use with your body. You can spin on your head, do the helicopter, you can do leg kicks, but this is more like gymnastics set to music or martial arts set to music. Along with those elements, you also have street knowledge. Street knowledge is the common knowledge and consciousness of the culture. If there's a particular concert coming up, if you have street knowledge, you might know, hey, 50 Cent will be at the Orpheum next week. Everyone might not know that, but the common consciousness will allow that information to be passed amongst friends. Street language, that's something we always hear. I could say today, hello, everyone. Or I could say, hey, what's up? You all right? You good? But street language, depending on what audience or who you're speaking to, you have a certain dialect and dialogue that you would have with that person. You also have street entrepreneurialism. And what that is with rap music, when we first started out with this in the 70s, peace, unity, love, and having fun. This was something to keep us out of trouble. This was something for us to party and have fun with. We weren't looking at the financial aspects at that point. Once rap seemed to draw an audience, then we began to try to understand how can we then take our talents and put money into our pocket. Spirituality comes in because a big thing in these urban communities is that it's not enough to just have religion. You have to be able to dissect your religion. And one of the things that a lot of the youth even today do is thinking about eliminating the distance between yourself and your personal beliefs. If you have a belief in a higher power, it's not just enough to say you believe that. You have to walk in that example. And you have a lot of youth today taking on different methods to express their spirituality. So we have graffiti art, DJing, MCing, street knowledge, street language, street fashion, street entrepreneurialism, and the other one, which I won't demonstrate, beatboxing. That's using the body as an instrument. Back in the days, we did not have certain instruments we could play with. Did that stop? No. Because a common belief was that we can make something out of nothing. So if you can put a beat in your mouth, I'll rap to it. I'll dance to it. So you use your body as an instrument. You use that to convey the music that we can rap over. And what I want to do also is give you a quick example before I pass the mic on of sampling. Sampling is an aspect of hip hop that has to do with the DJs. Because we're talking about environments in which certain people would not have enough money to buy an instrument or enough money to have music lessons, but still have the same urging to want to go out and to play music and to convey and express themselves, what do? Sampling became a big piece of the culture where artists would take sounds of music that they would hear and they would take particular parts of that song and then do what is called looping, where we have a certain piece of a song, we take that part of a song and we put it together. This is very ingenious. So I can't play a song, I can't guitar or piano, but I know what I like to hear. And what I want to do for you is give you a quick example of that, and then I will pass the mic. All right, you guys ready for this? You good? You still with us, right? All right, good. Just got this MP3. All right, so this is a song called Illegal Business by a gentleman by the name of KRS-One. Now, what you hear is he sampled a piece of a song from a Fat Albert cartoon. You guys remember Fat Albert? Fat Albert is part of the culture. So he's adding the bass along with the little round, round. That's from the cartoon. And now you can hear Fat Albert's voice. And what Fat Albert is going to say is very key to why we would do sampling. All right, so Fat Albert is saying, what can we get for 63 cents? Now, we all have seen Fat Albert, right? This is very key. In this particular episode of Fat Albert and the Cosby Kids, they want to start a band. And they said, well, what do we need to do? We need to get some instruments. Well, we need money. So each of them, Fat Albert, Dumb Donald, Mushmouth, they all went out and did different things. Someone washed windows. Someone ended up going and working with the butcher, the baker, the candlestick maker. They did all of these things. At the end of the day, they combined their money. And what they had is 63 cents after doing a whole day's work. They went down to the pawn shop and they talked to the gentleman that was working there. And they looked at all these instruments and he gave prices, $300 for this, $50 for that. And then he looked at Fat Albert and said, well, what do you have? And Fat Albert said, what can you get for 63 cents? And when you look at the end of any program of Fat Albert, they didn't buy the instruments. They put them together themselves. Fat Albert is playing like a radiator at the end of the cartoon. Someone is playing the bathtub. And with sampling, that was the same method. We don't have any money, but yet we have this ideal, and we want to convey that, and we're going to use other parts of the culture to do that. Thank you. It's going to be a good night.
Good evening. Can everybody hear me? Okay. When I was first asked to participate in this program, obviously I believe I was approached because I was a pop culture columnist for the Boston Globe, and I do pop commentaries for WBUR and NPR and WBUR. But then I really told myself that the reason why I was here is because I've been a hip-hop fan for 30 years. Now that's longer than hip-hop's had a name. The parties that Phil talked about in the Bronx, I was at those parties. I roller skated. Hip-hop was my life from the time I was 14, 15 years old. I even had a mercifully brief career as a graffiti writer. My name was Sister G with a halo. What I found really interesting in Beverly's opening comments is that she said that we're dealing tonight with a topic that touches all of us, whether we know it or not. And I think there's a tendency of a lot of people to look at hip-hop as something that kids do or black people do. And hip-hop has so permeated our culture in every single way. If you have any doubt that hip-hop has become the most dominant cultural movement of the last quarter century, there's an Avis commercial which features a bunch of senior citizens renting really cool cars as DMX's Rough Riders anthem plays in the background. If you still have any doubt, you can watch the news in pretty much any city at any time, and you will hear some anchorman or anchorwoman use the word bling when discussing jewelry. Oh, by the way, if you're ever tempted to use the word bling, just don't. As hip-hop has grown, however, what has continued to happen with the culture is that the way it's put out in the mainstream has narrowed. In Isaiah's opening comments, he mentioned that, you know, hip-hop could be threatening, it could be hostile, but at the same time, it could also be politically provocative, as Public Enemy often was in the song like Fight the Power. It could be gentle, as Tupac was with Dear Mama, or it could be funny, like Biz Markie's Just a Friend. But those aren't the sides of hip-hop that are often being shown. In recent years, hip-hop has really been narrowed down to this sort of cliched circus of drive-bys, materialism, and strip clubs. That's not the hip-hop I grew up listening to, and that's not the hip-hop that's still out there. Now, I'm not a you know, conspiracy theorist. You know, I'm not one of those people who feels like, you know, there's a big dark secret behind everything. Frankly, I believe Oswald acted alone. So, I'm not a conspiracy theorist. But I think there's something to be said when this incredibly dominant culture gets dumbed down and its strength gets taken away. We have to ask ourselves why that is. You know, hip-hop, you know, when you listen to the way that the terminology, the clothes, the way it's in all sorts of areas, it's in politics, it's in fashion, it's in advertising, the way that's had that kind of impact, you have to wonder what impact it can do if it became a real social force in the way that it would not just be telling kids to go out and buy 24-inch rims for their cars, but it was really giving them ideas about what's happening in their community beyond the violence and how to change what's going on in their community. That's the power of hip-hop. Anybody who thinks less really hasn't been paying attention. It's so much a part of what we do and how we think that I sometimes do think that there is an effort to take away its power by bringing it down to its lowest common denominator, by dumbing it down, by having a bunch of guys in sagging jeans and backwards baseball caps talking about tip drills, which I will explain to anybody who wants to know what that is after, not, I won't explain it right now. You know, or the whisper song or things of that sort, which in which you have, you know, murder, mayhem, and essentially women presented as semen receptacles. There is simply more to hip-hop than what you're getting in the mainstream. And I think that it's sort of incumbent upon all of us, you know, because essentially the record companies will, their job is to put out what sells. They don't care. If conscious hip-hop sells, that's what they'll put out. If nonsense sells, that's what they'll put out. The power is always in the hands of the people who are actually buying the records, because the record industry is only responding to what's out there. In his 2003 song, Moment of Clarity, Jay-Z, who's one of the most revered and influential figures in hip-hop history, and is also, for those who don't know, Beyonce's boyfriend, rapped, "Truthfully, I want to rhyme like common sense, but I did 5 mil and I ain't been rhyming like common since." Common is a Chicago rapper who's always favored conscious rap, meaning he shuns the sort of the rote cliches of gangsterism and misogyny and tends more towards social activism. But what Jay-Z was saying is that in mainstream hip-hop doesn't welcome a place for creativity and intellectually ambitious rap music. And that's what rap has always been. You know, rap was party music, and you had things like, you know, Run DMC's Rock Box, and you had Rapper's Delight, which was the first rap song to make it into the top 40. But a few years later, you also had Grandmaster Flash's The Message, which really put across what was going on in the inner cities. And it wasn't just doing it in this, you know, I got a gun, and I'm shooting up this one. I got my gat, and I'm strapped. That wasn't the point. The point was to say, look, you people aren't paying attention. This is what's happening. This is what's going to explode if you don't pay attention. It didn't revel in it, and it was much more an example of reportage than the idea that, you know, we're just going to glorify violence and mayhem. I think that, you know, hip-hop is what a lot of cases your kids are listening to. Hip-hop is going to be what your grandchildren are going to be listening to. Hip-hop isn't going away. Anyone who thinks it's a fad or a novelty is that it's been around for 30 years and it just keeps building and getting stronger. But I think the challenge as we all go forward in sort of hip-hop is in acknowledging hip-hop as a part of our culture is that there has to be a greater diversity of ideas and viewpoints presented in mainstream hip-hop. You can find much more in hip-hop in the underground and independent labels, but it's not what the major labels are putting out, and I think there has to be there. I think it's not just a matter of hip-hop surviving, but I think it also becomes a matter of hip-hop continuing to thrive. Thank you.
Good evening. Can you hear me? Hey, what's up? I want to make one statement to begin with and sort of fold it into connecting with the elements that Phil talks about. First of all, I want to say that writing is hip-hop, reading is hip-hop, and researching is hip-hop. I'm coming at this from an academic perspective. I've been reading, writing, and researching hip-hop for about 15 years now. And one of the things that I've found is that increasingly hip-hop is in the university, and I think it's for better, but there are an awful lot of resistant forces in universities who would prefer it's not there. one of the things that I want to address is the educational imperative in hip-hop, that when we talk about street knowledge, I think we can talk about other more formal forms of knowledge and sites where that knowledge is the project, is the work. And this extends from elementary schools right up through our university systems. At the university level, obviously, the walls of the university, the gates of the university are entirely permeable. And over the past 15 years, what we've seen is that hip-hop has come into the university in the headphones of our students, in the sensibilities of our students, students who are fully attuned to these elements that Phil referred to, fully attuned to all the media references that Renee just made. And so it's already, in a sense, in the university. So the challenge is, how do we accommodate it and also provide the educational foundation that the students deserve and that they're paying for, actually, as well. I want to say then that one of the things that a lot of people forget is that hip-hop has expanded beyond its merely cultural entertainment facets and is, I think, part of the broader range of cultural practices, which does include research and the like. We can talk about hip-hop as an element to help focus other important areas of social debate and academic research. Around issues of race, around issues of gender, about class structures, about the cultural politics and politics of this nation. Hip-hop has been dealing with these things since its inception, and so it makes entire sense that it has a place in the university, that these can be continued to be taken up. The caveat here is that the university needs hip-hop an awful lot more than hip-hop needs the university. There are three issues that I'm going to raise here. One is the question that comes up in hip-hop all the time around issues of authenticity, I think. Who is hip-hop? And it's defined in that hip-hop is so fully part of how people identify themselves that it's not unusual. In fact, it's common to say, I am hip-hop. The other side of that, of course, is this exclusive notion that, and you're not, right? And so we have to check. Who is I call the sheriff of Nottingham, hip-hop's policemen who are policing the boundaries of what is and isn't hip-hop. I was at a conference in early March out at Stanford, and this issue came up as the artists came into the room of an academic conference and basically said, you guys are frauds. You know, you guys aren't doing hip-hop. You're academics. You're talking about it, thinking about it, but you aren't out in the hood. And I want to challenge that by suggesting that there's a certain anti-intellectual strain that goes along with these kinds of attacks from the street, from the hood, when confronting people who are very much part of hip-hop and doing research, trying to understand it and in a sense legitimize many of its claims about society. The other thing, and this is an important one, is who owns hip-hop in terms of appropriation? What happens when something out in the street that's part of a lived culture and something that definitely is a central core facet of cultural practice among usually young African American and Latinos gets appropriated by middle-class white folks such as myself in a place like Northeastern University? I'm building my career on the backs of these brothers and sisters out there, and I have to remain aware of that, and there's a responsibility that goes to that. So that part of the attack and criticism, I think, is viable and legitimate. The other one is disciplinary aspects, ownership. Who owns hip-hop? What place shall house hip-hop? And traditionally, it's been African American studies departments. That's changing. Again, there's a little bit of conflict there. What happens when hip-hop is popping up in sociology departments, media departments, economics, criminal justice, English? It's in all of these disciplines now. Who's teaching these courses? What are their responsibilities and commitments to the culture? And again, I think this needs to be taken up very, very carefully. And I think the other one is spatial aspects. Who has access to universities at all, right? Over at Northeastern, we're at the edge of Roxbury, and young folks come up through the university all the time. They use our facilities in various ways. They go and get burgers at Burger King and the like, but they're not in the classrooms to nearly the extent that they could be or should be. And so that aspect of I'm in my class talking about hip-hop, and these young kids who are living it under some adverse conditions don't even have access to the university classrooms, we got a problem. So these things need to be addressed, I think. Another one I think I can talk about is authority and authenticity around the idea of responsibility of hip-hop scholars to the community. How in our research do we give back to the community? How do we make sure that the people who are living hip-hop most fully maybe have access to some of the information? I wrote a book on hip-hop that now I realize it was pretty much impenetrable, probably, for most people who don't have a university education. That's my problem, ultimately, not theirs. So we have, you know, at some point, you don't want to dilute the theory and the analysis, but how do we make sure that there's a volume of information that's available to a wider range of people? And I think within the mission, one of the missions that I claim is that how do we make sure that information is being presented to high school students in a way to say, you don't have to surrender hip-hop to come into the university. You can be hip-hop, do hip-hop, become a PhD and do hip-hop studies, and that will be welcomed. There are internal challenges. One is the traditional high culture, low culture kind of debates around popular culture, that hip-hop isn't deemed somehow valuable and relevant for a university setting. These battles have been fought around film studies, television studies, popular music studies for years, for decades. So I think hip-hop is up to that challenge. We're okay there. But there's a traditionalist and conservative element in universities that still really say, do we have, and this is a question I got from a senior faculty member, do we have anything to learn from these young black kids who are into hip-hop? Yeah. And as long as that attitude among senior faculty, people with a great deal of power and influence in decisions made in the university, as long as those values are still present and prevalent and have some traction, then we do have some internal battles to fight. Another one is age and generational dissonance. That was an older faculty member, I'll admit that. A scholar out at USC, Todd Boyd, has written about what he calls the decline of influence and power of the civil rights movement and civil rights politics, and, you know, pointing continually to Rosa Parks and Martin Luther King and the like, and saying, in fact, young kids are part of a new identity, a new set of cultural values, and we have to, in fact, make that transition effectively, and I think an important way in the university. The other one, I'll just move on to a couple of emergent areas, I think, of relevance to hip-hop studies. One, I think, is the area of sociology, and I think Jeff is going to address some of that in relationship to criminal justice issues. But sociology, where some of the key issues about race, class, and politics of poverty and the like are taken up. Hip-hop's been talking about these before it was recorded, back when Renee was talking, when she was roller skating. Hip-hop was also addressing these issues then. Sociology departments are very well poised to take the lead in that, and they are, to some extent. I think there's a lot of research in black masculinity. As much as most hip-hop is produced by young black men, that the themes that we hear, many of us might say, that's pretty distasteful, or that's pretty aggressive, or it's unacceptable to draw the line right there. We might say, well, what is this issue? Is this an issue of a hip-hop nature, or is this an issue of another kind of nature? And I think a lot of real progressive people like Byron Hurt, like Kevin Powell, like Bakari Katwana, like Mark Anthony Neal, are doing some amazing research in terms of black masculinity, trying to understand how that is a facet of hip-hop and the content of an awful lot of the culture that we encounter. Another thing, I've heard a couple of comments about youth and hip-hop, and I think it's safe to say we can reject that now. So I'm just looking around here, and I'm seeing a little gray hair up on the panel here, you know, and some of us are losing the hair we have, you know. So this idea of hip-hop as youth culture, I think, does need to be challenged. We are now moving into our third generation of hip-hop-identified individuals. And I'm 46 years old, and there are people older than me, some of the pioneers that Phil mentioned. And so what happens now when we've got people talking about different eras, different generations of hip-hop, different political values that they've experienced in and through hip-hop. I hope we get to the term that Renee mentioned, back in the day, as it's historically imprecise, but back in the day to me and Renee and Phil and Jeff, and back in the day to our students or to young people we encounter, mean completely different things. So there's this generational dissonance that I think is incredibly important. just before I sign off, Nelly, younger MC, very, very popular, went after one of the venerable greats, KRS-One. You heard some of his material here. And he said, you're basically called him old and said he's falling off. He said he'll be the first MC to be on a hip hop pension. And then more recently, Cameron went after Jay-Z, who you heard referred to here, and he sort of, it was a pretty lame attack. He didn't show much dexterity or skill, but he basically said, you're old, you're 40. So I think the area of generation is an area of I think, relevance and interest in the Academy. And then finally, the global expansion of hip-hop. U.S. and North American-based hip-hop has been researched really thoroughly. The history is well-known. There's much more to work on, clearly. But kind of the unknown factor and facet is the international scope and the way hip-hop's been taken up as an American black cultural form and the way it's been resituated in more local, regional, or national contexts around the world. Thank you.
Good evening. Murray said he was going to list three things, and then he tried to list everything so I wouldn't have anything left to say, but he failed at that. No, I just want to start off by saying that I have the pleasure and fortune of being a member of both the Athenaeum and an alumni of the partnership, and never before have those two experiences intersected as they are right now. I spent much of my summer last summer, and I'll be here again this summer, working on a book on the fifth floor, and I'd come down and see the evening receptions, and they would be about Dutch farmers in the 13th century, and I would make my way to the tea, but it's a delight to be here tonight and talk about an issue that's so important, I think, and that is particularly compelling to me and a lot of us in this room. I'd like to focus my remarks on what I consider to be some of the more fascinating aspects of hip-hop, and that is, in particular, its sociological and anthropological dimensions. So to shift the conversation a little bit away from artistry in the Academy and talk a little bit about how we understand hip-hop and what we gain by thinking about hip-hop as a phenomena of modern human societies. Like Murray, there's something about academics, they want to list everything in threes, and I'm going to say there are three specific fascinations I have here, and I believe there are actually three, and I'm going to, if I have time, I'd like to talk about those with more specificity relative to some recent developments, but if not, I'll save that for conversation. The first interesting sociological facet is hip-hop's function as what I want to call a floating signifier. Hip-hop functions as a sort of unstable, and this is why it's floating, symbol or label. Hip-hop essentially constructs meaning for us. It applies a frame of reference to people, to places, to things. Hip-hop is, for example, and we've seen this tonight, shorthand for young, black, urban, shorthand for quote-unquote edgy. This notwithstanding, these significations, notwithstanding the facts that hip-hop culture attracts and reflects the ideas of a far more diverse population of practitioners, and notwithstanding the heterogeneity within the black, young urban set, and to say nothing of Murray's point about the aging issue within hip-hop. Finally, this notion of edgy persists, notwithstanding the fact that much of what today we call hip-hop is no more edgy than a repeat episode of Friends. These realities are somewhat irrelevant to hip-hop's function as a signifier. As with all signifiers, the social uses of hip-hop in constructing meaning can drift from its social realities. So hip-hop is a floating signifier of politics, culture, and identity. Floating because its meaning is unstable and subject to continual reconstruction. And this instability has much to do with the fact that hip-hop can and does function as both an externally ascribed identity and a self-defined identity. Simultaneously functions as an identity-making machine. In this sense of signification, so far as we are aware of hip-hop in our culture, in our society, we have hip-hop cultural politics, regardless of whether we love it or hate it or claim to be indifferent. So that's one connection, that's sociological. A second is hip-hop's existence as an imagined community. Hip-hop has constructed, I want to suggest, an imagined community, and it's not a novel sort of construction. In a book about the sociological impact of the printing press and literature, Benedict Anderson discussed how people separated by oceans, cultures, and more, who had never seen each other and who likely never would, suddenly imagined themselves as part of a community. The texts and story worlds that were made possible by print created this imagined community, a community of quote-unquote learned people who shared common understandings and status through the consumption and production of words. Well, in the last third of the 20th century, hip-hop culture appeared to have a similar effect in constructing an imagined community. Through the consumption and production of hip-hop cultural texts, music, visual art, film, literature, and so on, young people, who eventually got older, if they were lucky, and replaced by new young people developed an imagined community variously described as the hip-hop nation, the hip-hop community, hip-hop heads, and in other ways I'm likely not privy to. We know very little about the boundaries and landscape of this imagined community. We know little about its significance in the lives of its inhabitants or those who identify with it. As I'll elaborate on in a minute, there's a common assumption, however, that there is something real to this community, namely a real and robust network of affinities and social relations. But it's unclear whether this too is imagined. The final point I want to make about the sociological and anthropological significance of hip-hop is the existence of its material culture. Beyond functioning as a floating cultural signifier, hip-hop has actually generated a vast material culture, a vast physical expression that is scattered presently around the world. Some of it's organized, but distributed widely, I should say. This beautiful library, the Boston Athenaeum, in all of its stacks, could not likely contain the artifacts of hip-hop culture that were only produced in the northeastern United States in the last 30 years. And if you consider that hip-hop has inspired creative works around this country and around the world, reflecting the aesthetics of different times and places, and that further, it is likely that only a fraction of this work has made it into the market being a sort of preserving, a perverse but preserving kind of institution, you get a sense of the vastness of hip-hop's material culture. I have, for a very long time, been interested in attempting to gather, organize, and analyze this material culture. And there are, in fact, hip-hop archives springing up in Boston and other parts of the country at such venerable institutions as Stanford University, as Murray mentioned, the Schoenberg Center in Harlem, which is connected to the New York Public Library, and perhaps most recently, the Smithsonian. If we genuinely intend to understand the historic and sociological significance of hip-hop, I want to maintain, if we want to do more than trade and hip-hop signifiers, or what I like to call occasionally poke hip-hop with a long stick and see what happens, we have to take stock of its material culture. There is an intellectual challenge to thinking and talking and working seriously with hip-hop. And there is great, I think, potential in that process. I'd like to take a couple of seconds now, now that I've talked about these kind of abstract notions of hip-hop, to, I was hoping I wouldn't get the 1 minute slide. I sort of tipped my hand, I think. Well, let me just say, let me just point out the ironies of these realities by juxtaposing a couple of recent developments, and I'll elaborate on these when, if I have a chance when we're in conversation. One of these developments is mobilization of the hip-hop signifier, claims that we will progress as a society by turning hip-hop off. The other claims, paradoxically, that we will progress by turning hip-hop on. So, the first one, we see in a series of articles recently in the New York Times and other papers, noting the worsening plight of black men relative to issues of employment, violence, education, public health, and so on. In this debate, there tends to be a juxtaposition of arguments, one claiming that socioeconomic factors explain this, the other claiming that it's culture. One of the more recent installments by Orlando Patterson, sociologist at Harvard, points to the cultural significance, the cultural dimensions of this problem. Now, he doesn't argue that these are mutually exclusive, that culture is totally separate from socioeconomic factors. But he says we need to talk more about culture. And he ends up saying that we need to teach young black men when they should turn hip-hop off. He says that white kids into hip-hop know that at some point you turn hip-hop off and study for the SAT. Black youth haven't gotten this lesson. Now, on the one hand, I know what he means. I have students in my class who I wish would turn hip-hop off, who would not talk to me as though we were at a concert, or play the phone to sing the jingles that they have on their cell phone in class. On the other hand, if we consider that hip-hop is at once an ascribed identity and self-identified, category of self-identification, it becomes problematic to think about turning hip-hop off. How does the young man who's decided to turn hip-hop off and study for the SAT and then goes to apply for a job convince the employer who sees in him the embodiment of hip-hop and its dangers, convince that person that in fact they've turned hip-hop off and they're now not hip-hop, they're something else? The white counterpart doesn't have this same problem in the sense that our ascribed identity of hip-hop is racialized. So let me wrap up here, and if I have a chance, I'll come back to the example of turning hip-hop on, because I think it's, like this example, illustrative of the point that, one, we must take hip-hop's historical and sociological significance and complexity seriously. Two, that we must do less poking of hip-hop with a distant stick. And three, that we are challenged to do more to identify and harvest the real potential of hip-hop culture in its community. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, what wonderful thoughts and ideas you shared with us. Ladies first, Renee. Hit us with a question.
That's also the name of a Queen Latifah song, Ladies First. I want to ask Murray, who mentioned the global impact of hip-hop, in the ways that North American hip-hop has obviously influenced what we're hearing in other countries. Do you have any evidence that what is happening out there in the world is also influencing hip-hop here?
I don't in terms of content. Partly because, you know, when I don't speak German and I'm here. Yeah, in terms of beats, absolutely. It isn't a unidirectional flow at all. And I think probably the most obvious one, and, you know, we live over in Roxbury, we've heard the change over the past, you know, several years, is the rise of Latin-based rhythms in hip-hop, not just through reggaeton, but a continual influence at various levels. And talking about hip-hop, a lot of people often will say, well, it's a black cultural formation, and I wouldn't argue that, except to say that you know, when it jumped off in the Bronx, blacks and Latinos were inhabiting the same social spaces, going to the same parties, and they were always working together in the formation of hip-hop. So there's a historical sense of this hybrid form already, and I think as hip-hop goes global, you're hearing a little bit more of it. Also, coming back to Phil's notion of sampling, it's never been easier to take little musical snippets from other global cultures, the sound of an instrument from Australia, maybe a pub song or a drinking song from Germany, mix it all together, and you've got a great track. So yeah, there is this global hybridity that's going on.
Phil. Thank you, Marie. Phil, a question, please.
Yes, I wanted to go back to how we doing out there. We all right? Okay. Back to Jeff, and to talk a little bit more about that, the complexity. Like, for example, the race issue. A lot of times that can shut people off from wanting to go beyond just talking about rap lyrics and then really moving into more of those social aspects. But a little bit more about that complexity.
I encountered that very issue here, and the example I was going to point to in terms of the contrast with Patterson's claim that we should turn hip-hop off is the claim that hip-hop can be useful in politically organizing disaffected youths who are on the margins of our electoral process and democratic participation. And so here the argument is turning hip-hop on, and we can take advantage of hip-hop's imagined melting pot, for example, to organize young people across lines that have historically divided our society, race and ethnicity, religion, class, to formulate common political agendas and organize in pursuit of those agendas. Well, I was a part of the organizing committee of the National Hip Hop Political Convention in 2004. And we had this idea. We thought this was going to be, we had a radical opportunity here to stimulate democratic participation in discourse. And one of the things we encountered in that context was the persistence of racial politics. I was part of this national group, but one of my charges was to organize a convention. A delegation from Boston to come to the convention in Newark, New Jersey in the summer of 2004. And we had a series of meetings. Initially, the meetings were attended by young white, Asian American, Hispanic, African American people. And very quickly, in the course of our discussion about what our agenda issues are and how we should organize and what we're going to do when we get to Newark, the question of authenticity emerged, and it was a racialized discourse on authenticity, where, and I don't mean to essentialize racial groups here, but in terms of the cast of characters in the room, one African-American participant in the discussion said, well, hip-hop is black, and hip-hop politics have to be about black politics. And, you know, here I am, the organizer, I think, yeah, this is quite against what we had envisioned as the potential for this effort, and I too here as the college professor with the complexion for the connection and and using big words and what do you know about hip hop anyway? So race permeates this issue in the most obvious and overtly divisive, exclusionary ways we can imagine, and in a lot more subtle, surprising ways as we have encountered in this experience.
Thank you, Jeff. Murray, you have a question for us.
Yeah, I'd like to ask this one, pose this one to Renee, that part of your work at the Globe, and I loved your work at the Globe, by the way, is I almost saw it as a translational job, bringing something from one world, the hip-hop world, into a context that was legible and perhaps comprehensible to a general readership. What was that like? Have I misframed it? And what was it like being a journalist in a hip-hop setting, bringing this culture, this vibrant and very vast culture to a general readership?
Strange. the issue, I never felt the issue was as much in dealing with the public as it was in trying to get certain ideas and concepts past my editors. I remember having a vigorous conversation about the word biatch and what the word meant. It's sort of a slang for bitch. And and what its origins were and how it was spelled. I just remember having this whole conversation. I'm like, well, I spell it B-E-E, you know, hyphen, Y-A-T-C-H. And this whole thing, we're going back and forth with it. And the whole, I just wanted to argue to get the word in the paper because it was within the context of a lyric. You know, so you had a lot of that, but that was more about, sort of, you know, standards and practices at the Globe and what's appropriate for general readership. I think what I often tried to do with hip-hop was, you know, I was always aware of the fact that I was writing for the Boston Globe, and I wasn't writing for the source. And I think it's the same with everything. If you're a sports writer, you know, you have certain liberties you can take, assuming the people who read it are going to be baseball fans or football fans, but you're also aware of the fact that you're not writing for Sports Illustrated, that you are writing for a general readership. So I think that was what I always tried to do. I tried to present it in not really general terms. I tried to be, you know, intellectual about it or funny, whatever the case called for, but I think it was always a matter of the understanding that I was writing for a much wider audience than, you know, than my friends or people who necessarily were, you know, intimately involved in the hip-hop culture.
Thank you, Renee. Sure.
I wanted to follow up with Phil about the work he's doing. When I mentioned that I've been long interested in organizing hip-hop artifacts, it's not only because I want to sort of go in a dark, dusty room and look at them, but because I have the feeling that these materials can be used to do skill development and other sort of socially pro-social developmental work with young people who are not very much interested in the curriculums they're being fed today. So would you say a little bit more about what you're doing with hip-hop and how you find it useful?
Yeah, indeed. One of the things, too, one of the elements I left out was street fashion, but I think the panel cleared that up. But the way you dress, how you look, looking fly. With working with the younger population, one of the things that I do with my programs, for example, the Career Connection Program, how do you get youth to assemble somewhere? And then how do you deliver the services that you have? And one of the trademarks that I have has a lot to do with the world of hip-hop. It's simply this. When teachers go into an environment and speak to students, let's say, for example, in a format that seems as though they're lecturing, and there's no transition from teacher to someone that's actually trying to get you to join into a program, students have this thing that we only deal with teachers in the classroom. Outside of that, you're still a teacher, and we're not going to differentiate that. One of the things that hip-hop allows me to do is that hip-hop is an awareness. It's an awareness of what's going on. So my approach is always very different. If my goal is to get students to enroll in the program, I don't start with that when I speak to them. Have to know the latest topics and the latest albums. Not because I want to buy that album, but this begins the discourse with the young person. This is what they're into. I might be into Michael Jordan, this generation. And that's a very funny thing. Like Michael Jordan, for example, as good as he was, he's out the door right now. LeBron James is the number one guy. And whether his stats prove it or not, because he's marketed like that, and he is good, but because you can be marketed in such a way, that is the person that you can talk to the youth about, and then you begin that dialogue. And then from there, we talk about LeBron, talk about Jay-Z, then we move into an application. Got this program going on, why don't you check it out? You have some friends, why don't you bring them along? So it's very critical in the sense of getting youth to assemble. Now I'm working with 14 to 18-year-olds at the high school. I also work with 5th and 4th graders. And it's the same thing. It doesn't mean I talk to them about rap, but it's the tone you use. I talk about SpongeBob. I might talk about, and that's because that's the reference point. We might say, what is your top 10 favorite cartoons? I know about Dora the Explorer, Swiper No Swiping. And the kids are like, oh, you know about Swiper? Now, what's happening is, what's going on in my mind as we talk about hip-hop as an awareness, what's the consciousness that I'm trying to do? I'm building credibility. So with the teachers come to me and say, Phil, well, what did you do? It's about credibility. You have it, and you have everything that's going to benefit the youth. But because they see you as teacher, it's knocking some of your credibility. And I think that's a big part. It plays a significant part into it, where in some places it comes into that whole invisible man theory again, where they see me as what they assume, opposed to what I really am. And that benefits me in terms of being able to have youth assemble. When I worked for a university, one of my jobs was to go into a middle school in Dorchester and build up their after-school program. Short story, 25 students was enrolled, wanted to try to get it up to maybe 35, 50 students. We had 120 students enrolled in less than 4 months. Now, here's something about awareness that was very striking. Of my team, I was the only African-American male. And the gentleman I was working with at the middle school, he was the liaison for all after-school programs. Mine was one of five. One of the problems was that basketball was dominating. So anyone that signed up for after-school programs wanted to do basketball. So one of my suggestions was, we have parks outside. Why don't we check out a park? The gentleman told me, and this was a Caucasian male, probably 55 years of age, very good person, but here's where the awareness part comes in. He told me, as someone coming in, that the parks around here are not safe enough to take these students out there. There are a lot of gangs out there. There's a lot of violence. That hip-hop stuff is going on out there. The other part is that I'm not the invisible man. I'm Phil Haddix, suit and tie, and I'm also this teacher figure. So he is also looking at me as someone where, as the park is scared for him, it's going to be scared for me. So going home that night, I said, you know, I'm going to walk by there before I get on the train station. When I went down to the park, and awareness, I'm not going down there as a fool. If it was some things going on, I was going to go right to the train. But you have to have awareness, but not be crazy. But when I went down there, I'm looking for this group, because there are things where there's older people around there, drugs, it's true in some aspects. When I got down there, one of the first groups I ran into said, hey, how you doing, Mr. H? Hey, Phil, what was going on? These were the school students. The group he assumed was the ones that's causing trouble are in his classroom at 8 o'clock in the morning. Yet, he is thinking he's saving me to not go work with them when I'm trying to recruit students to be in the program. So it's very critical to have that awareness. Hip hop can provide it.
Thank you, Phil. Ladies and gentlemen, what a wonderful panel. Panel, what a wonderful audience. An audience that is as attentive as you are is an audience that is full of questions. And we'll ask Stephen Nonak if he'll help with the mic.
I'd like to ask Mr. Ward why he thinks Orlando Patterson suggested that the young blacks give up hip-hop. And I'd like to ask Phil if he read the op-ed by Orlando Patterson.
I can actually start, because no, I did not. Actually, when we spoke earlier today, they just had alerted to me that it was a rebuttal was written about the article.
In fairness to Patterson's argument, I think what he meant essentially was that black youth need to learn how to code switch. Switch off the hip-hop code, switch on the American mainstream code. And I think I'd say two reasons why. I don't pretend to be able to get into his head, but I think on the one hand, he's recognizing that there's a penalty attached to performing hip-hop publicly. But on the other hand, he's arguing, well, and there's a penalty attached to it partly because it's not appropriate for certain environments. But he's also, I think, arguing that because he's limiting hip-hop to a certain signification, a signification of anti-intellectualism, of boisterousness, of kind of irresponsibility as work and routine are concerned. And I think the reality of hip hop is that those are not necessarily antithetical skill sets or dispositions, but he's using a specific signifier of hip-hop and thus says, turn hip-hop off when it's time to study or when it's time to go get a job.
Hi, Jeff Quinlan. I'd like to ask our panel for some help in placing hip-hop as a cultural phenomena in a broader historical context. And if we look at the last 30 years of hip-hop, we can see cultural movements before hip-hop, rock and roll, before that jazz, before that even people like Schoenberg and Stravinsky accused of attempting to destroy music and so forth. Please help us understand a broader historical context of hip-hop as a cultural phenomenon.
Can you say the last? I missed the last part of what you said.
If you could please help us understand hip-hop as in its historical context as one of a number of different cultural movements that encompassed dance and movement and song and culture and social energy and all these different things. Hip-hop is one movement among many. How would you compare and contrast?
30 years of hip-hop in 30 seconds. Here we go. I think what I always found interesting about hip-hop in the beginning was that there was nothing else like it beforehand. It didn't really grow out. I mean, people will say that if you go back to Louis Armstrong and the music he was making with the Hot Fives and the Hot Sevens in the 1920s, and he was scatting, that was the first version of beatboxing. And if you think about it, there's a certain continuum there. There's something about how hip-hop was sort of growing and growing, and the mainstream culture, I think, was so threatened by it that they turned it off for a long time. People really started to pay more attention to hip-hop, I think, you know, in the 90s and the mid-90s and on, but hip-hop had already been around at that point for over 15 years. So I think there's something fascinating about a culture that came from other, and really very much the other, when you're thinking of what the South Bronx was in the 1970s, where it was, you know, burned out, nobody was paying attention to it, and also where New York was at that time when you had, you know, Gerald Ford, Sioux City, dropped dead, the city was in default, the city was going bankrupt, and suddenly you had this cultural form that sort of developed out of nothing. I think that's a fascinating and sort of remarkable phenomenon to have come sort of so late in the century that something that everyone tried to ignore it suddenly really took over. I think, you know, there are lots of comparisons to be made with sort of hip-hop and the emergence of rock and roll, but hip-hop seemed much quicker in some way. I mean, rock and roll was sort of percolating there, and then it was like sort of this idea, and then it was, you know, race music, and then Elvis Presley came along and got all the credit for it, and then all these other sort of things happened. But hip-hop really wasn't that. I think there was something, what makes hip-hop remarkable is it was there, but there was this other sort of evolution going on in that, for the most part, the mainstream culture, or white culture, if you will, wouldn't touch it. It was just too threatening. They wanted to go away as a novelty. So I think that's, in my mind, what makes hip-hop such a phenomenon, that it continued to grow in an underground way and sort of seep its way into the mainstream when people really were trying to push it aside.
And you see that as different from jazz and the Lindy Hop that accompanied it?
I think by the time you get to Lindy Hop, I mean, you had the whole idea, but jazz began to come into the mainstream when you had various white bands who were starting to play it. People, you know, Louis Armstrong wasn't getting the credit, so you sort of had, you know, Paul Whiteman and his band, and then even into the 30s, you know, the big band was Benny Goodman. You know, it wasn't necessarily Chick Webb. But in hip-hop, it was Run DMC and Grandmaster Flash and the Treacherous Three and Jimmy Spicer and all these other bands who were coming along. It didn't need white acceptance as rock and roll and jazz did to make it into the mainstream. It pushed its way into the mainstream. It simply wouldn't be denied.
I'd like to maybe reposition it a little bit as well. Looking at it in a historical moment, I often see hip-hop's originary moments very similar to punk. They come out of the same moment. It's the same kind of do-it-yourself ethic and aesthetic to some extent. I won't say so much that they were anti-corporate, but they were definitely non-corporate in terms of, you know, that it was all independent labels, that sort of thing. And it was localized. It was very much scene-oriented. So this is, again, to speak to underground, not national. First play was on probably on campus and community radio stations, those sorts of things. So maybe look at it in terms of maybe not a deep historical trend, but the moment it emerges. The other thing is that, you know, why did they have street parties and that sort of thing? Well, a lot of these cats couldn't get into the clubs. right? So they, you know, they're going to do their own thing, and they're going to do it at the community houses or wherever, you know. And so its trajectory, I think, can be looked at in terms of other cultural movements that are going on. But hip-hop was very quickly adopted by the avant-garde movement in Greenwich Village and Lower East Side of New York. So these various movements saw and recognized one another, and that might be one way of thinking about its growth and trajectory.
I was just going to also add on with hip-hop also, looking historically, a lot of figures are left out in the sense of, it was a good point about where we look at punk music or the Clash, the Sex Pistols, and also when disco came around. When hip-hop was coming around, there is a part where we go back into the racial aspect of one group that's a part of the mainstream or could be, but decides to go off on their own in thinking about punk music. Hip-hop is not a part of the mainstream. Even if we wanted to be, Kool Herc was not going to be at Studio 54. He just was not going to be a part of that scene. He had to create it where it was at. Why are we partying here? This is the only place that we can go. The other part of it is that hip-hop is also connected to gospel music. What I did earlier, the call and response, that's Sunday morning at the church that's going on there. Also, Malcolm X, Martin Luther King, all of those figures are also connected. But Gil Scott Heron, the Last Poets, these are other figures that play a big part into how we deliver the music or things, the social aspect. You think about the poet Sonia Sanchez and what she was talking about, and rappers saying that, you know, we're doing a party scene, but look at the content that they have. And you have a rapper by the name of Melly Mel, who this guy is such a dominant figure. He was writing in the 80s, early 80s, 82, the song Beach Street. He not only talks about the wars that are going on and many that are happening today, but he also talks about the computer, never becoming a slave to the computer. This is before internet. This is before any of those things were thought of. He was talking about this. And even later, he had a song with the Clark Sisters, gospel group, and still talking about the computer. But I think a lot of times, hip-hop gets narrowed into thinking that it's only other rappers that have influenced it. Listening to my dad's record, him showing me James Brown, him talking to me about Duke Ellington, that was his expression. Mine came out through these rappers, but yet it's the same thing of how are you actually expressing yourself and what medium do you do it through?
Good evening. My name is Elijah Adamson. I go to Prospect Hill Academy Charter School. And I want to say that you guys brought up some interesting points, but there seems to be the general consensus that political hip-hop is a positive thing for the culture. And I want to say, why should we trust hip-hop figures to give us our political messages? And I mean, because most hip-hop artists, when they talk about politics, they're talking about the struggle, living in the ghetto, things like that. I mean, do you see fair and balanced hip-hop, you know, emerging anytime soon? I mean, they're obviously going to be talking about the struggle, but I mean, there are some things that the government is going to be doing good. So I want to know what your opinions are on hip-hop figures as political.
I'll take my messages from Nas over Bill O'Reilly any day.
It's a great question. You're right. I think we do over-valorize the political rappers and MCs and like to a fault. And in fact, this is a problem of academic research as well. Who gets talked about? KRS-One, Nas, you know, the Public Enemy. But people really aren't talking about Lil Jon and Trick Daddy and some of these cats, not to nearly the same extent, even though they're talking about highly political things, maybe cultural politics in another form. But just quickly, I would say that I think the change will come not when it's MCs who are being political and you know, talking about political issues and social issues on their raps, but when we have people like Mayor Kirkpatrick in Detroit, when we have Kevin Powell running for Congress in New York, when we have the first hip-hop president, right? No, and this is reality. We're going to have more and more, you know, as the generation continues to age, we're going to have people who are hip-hop identified or who got down at parties, who are making, you know, very important, you know, national and international policies, but who are also aware of what we might call hip-hop sensibility. So I think you're on the right track with that question. You're absolutely pointing to the right thing.
Jacques Joseph. I work on the Hill. My question is around hip-hop as a, I think the word you used was signifier, but a signifier for modernity. For example, I think it's really hard to think about modernity in the 20th century without jazz. How is hip-hop affecting our sensibility about modernity in the 21st century globally?
I'm going to try to actually connect this to the last question in a way. I think hip-hop is... hip-hop is used and misused to characterize modernity in the 21st century and the late 20th century. It has become a synonym of urban decay for a lot of users, particularly those external to the culture. It is the embodiment of all that's wrong with American cities, with American social policy, with American education. It is also, in a way, a signifier of the complexities of identity politics in modernity. A lot of sociologists, political theorists are talking about political identity politics that disrupt and intermingle old categories of identity towards the end of the 20th century. So no longer are people simply organizing along the lines of race or gender, but these intersecting identities of sexuality, of aesthetic, taste, and so forth. I mean, hip-hop is in a way very much a part of that story in a very mainstream way. I mean, not simply as it affects, as it relates to urban use of color. There is this notion that in the program for today, I have it here somewhere, it says that today, hip-hop has the potential to serve as a positive agent for change at the community and national levels. Quite an encouraging statement. One not commonly discovered in public discussions of hip-hop. And to the gentleman's question about why we should be so sanguine about the potential politically for hip-hop, I think it's a critical question. When we were organizing the National Hip-Hop Political Convention, there was this notion that we were going to have a sort of parade of progressive MCs come up and somehow deliver rhymes that had political messages, and everyone would leave the rally/concert informed politically and, you know, prepared to take positions on issues of the day. The idea was quite different, though. It was not that that we should look to artists as the sources of knowledge about politics and so on. It's that hip-hop constitutes an identity. It signifies a social status and a common experience. And because of that, one can reach out, and the point of Phil's point of awareness, say, hey, we all have similar interests, experiences, questions. Why don't we come together and have a convention about politics? There was a concert, but it was at the end. And ironically, the performer went on to say a bunch of crazy things that were not very progressive. But in the course of the it was Dougie Fresh who went on to share his conspiracy about how I won't go into it. But but let me just say, but in the course of this convention, 3,000 young people and some older came from around the country, delegations from places like Oregon, in New Jersey, Newark, Portland, Oregon, cities in California, Ohio, carrying signs that had their state name on it, you know, sitting in groups of 10 and 12 in an auditorium at the College of Rutgers University, came up with a five-point agenda focusing on education, economic justice, criminal justice, health, and human rights. And these were 14, 15, 17, 18, 20-something-year-old kids who went up to the microphone and said, I want to push that economic justice be on the agenda, and this is my specific amendment. And people would boo, you know. But over the course of 3 days, that event generated a political agenda, and local organizing committees went back to their communities. So the idea isn't that artists are going to lead the way, it's that they provide... they inspire a community that can be mobilized, potentially.
Thank you, Phil. Thank you, panelists. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for making this such a fulfilling evening for all. Thank you, Partnership. Thank you, Athenaeum. And thank you especially for the refreshments that are served in the outer hall.